Jose Magana is an immigration advocate, and he joins us in the studio tonight. Jose, thanks a lot for coming on.
Thanks for having me, Tucker.
So an armed and trained federal agent murdered by blunt force, probably by rocks. Why should that not scare the rest of us?
I think the situation is that that's not the norm at the border. The border, according to the U.S. Department of Homeland Security in a study 2 months ago, argued that the border is more secure than it's ever been, with 85% of undocumented immigrants being apprehended before they even enter the country.
Right, so 15% weren't. So it's not secure. By that definition, it's not secure. Here's the point. Look, I grew up next to Mexico. I like Mexico. Super nice people. Most immigrants are nice people.
I'm Mexican myself, Tucker.
But there's been a civil war, in effect, going on in Mexico for years. Over 110,000 people have been murdered in Mexico. Okay, it's one of the most violent countries in the world. If it were any country but Mexico and there wasn't this weird politics hovering over it, we would say, holy smokes. This is one of the most dangerous places in the world, right on our border. We need to make certain we know the identity of every single person who comes in or out. But we don't because of advocacy by people like you, because we somehow can't? I don't understand.
Well, Tucker, in 2013, we had the opportunity to fund over $43.6 billion, a good portion of that would go to border security through S-744, the bill that would legalize a large portion of the undocumented population. It had enormous border security provisions, and if you want to be mad at someone, you should be mad at the Republicans in the House that refused S-744.
Wait, hold on. No, wait a second. Why should we legalize anybody? It's our country.
Tucker.
I'm serious. We have a moral right to secure our borders. Again, I'm not impugning the character of Mexican citizens, many of whom I like. I'm just saying over 110,000 people have been murdered in that country in recent years. It's one of the most violent countries in the world. Why in the world, if you cared about the security of Americans, wouldn't you just shut down any border crossing except legal border crossing?
Well, according to DHS, the border is more secure now than it's ever been in the history of
totally
the United
secure,
States.
So,
and more funding would have been allocated to the border if not for Republicans attacked at 744.
Then you got to legalize everybody and all their family gets to move here. And like, what? No.
I don't think
people who are here legally get to decide what our policies are. In what world? Mexico doesn't allow that kind of nonsense. So like, be quiet. You're not a citizen. Go away. I'm serious. You know that's true.
The United States doesn't set its immigration policies based on what other countries does, Tucker. It sets and exercises its leadership based on what's just and fair and what aligns with our nation's commitment
to
equality and the melting pot.
There's massive lobbying by the governor of Mexico, which uses illegal immigration from Mexico as a pressure relief valve to keep their country from melting down because it's a corrupt place with a bad economy. And we are lobbied by them every single day, and you know that that's true, so don't pretend it's not.
Well, Tucker, I think you're ignoring the fact that net migration from Mexico is at net zero and has been for the past few several years. The fact that you're portraying
totally
the southern border as a flood of individuals coming isn't necessarily accurate.
People come from South America and from Central America through Mexico into the United States, and that is allowed, indeed encouraged, by the Mexican government, which doesn't want to deal with illegals in its borders either. So they come to our country, again, with the help of the Mexican government. I'm telling the truth, and you know that I am. And my point is, like, why should we put up with that? This is nuts. Like, let's stop pretending.
Because under our own immigration laws, we have a humanitarian responsibility to those Central Americans fleeing violence and persecution. Because under the INA, if you are being persecuted in your home country, you have an opportunity to present your case for relief here in the United States.
Really?
And these are mothers and children fleeing horrific violence in these Central American families.
There are over a billion people who are fleeing violence and poverty around the world. I don't understand what gave the United States the unique obligation to put them all in federal assistance. I mean, this is insane. Where does that come from? Is that in the Constitution? Like, so who made this up? And why do the rest of us have to stand here and be like, oh, absolutely, it's our obligation? Like, where does that come from, that obligation?
Our international obligations stem from the Immigration and Nationality Act and the various treaties that this nation has adopted that essentially said if you're being persecuted because of your race, because of your religion, if people are trying to murder you and your country won't help you, you can apply, and it's not a guarantee to come to this country and obtain refugee or asylum status.
But tell an unemployed American, and they're about, let's just see, 100 million of them in this country, why that serves their interests, because the U.S. government is supposed to be looking out primarily for their interests. How do they benefit from that? Oh, wait, there's no answer, because they don't, and you know that they
don't.
Well,
at the end of the day, economists from both the progressive and the conservative side have consistently said that immigration is good for our country, that immigration lifts all
boats. Has it been good for California, which is poorer now than it's ever been?
I think California cherishes its immigrants. That's why it's passed
various
laws.
But as an economic, and that's, I hear this line, but it's a lie, and you know it's a lie. California is poorer because of immigrants. It's got more poor people than any state in the union. It was the richest state in the country 30 years ago. So, like, if this magic formula works, where has it worked? Name a place where it's worked.
I think I would say both the Center for American Progress and Cato Institute from opposite spectrums arguing that immigration is good for California.
I don't care if you've got the Dalai Lama saying so.
Name one. And the fact that California legislators have encouraged immigrants being in their
state. Because there's a massive political lobby, as you know, but as an economic matter, name one state or municipality that has become more prosperous because of low-wage immigration.
Center for American Progress has a state-by-state analysis.
Name one. Okay, go ahead. Name one.
Every single state, Tucker, no state has experienced negative economic growth as a result of immigration. And regularizing the status of the 11 million undocumented immigrants in this country would promote economic growth and restart this country's economic engine.
Let me just say that that is a lie, and you know that it's a lie, and you can go to Lowell, Massachusetts, or Lewiston, Maine, or any place where large numbers of immigrants have moved into a poor community, and it hasn't become richer, it's become poorer. That's real. Go there. Do you know what I'm talking about or no?
I think at the end of the day, this contributes to the narrative that we've seen in our nation consistently, that oftentimes immigrants are scapegoated for economic woes.
I'm not scapegoating anybody. I'm asking you to prove your contention that immigration is always good for the economy. And
I would point to the repeated economic studies done by a wide variety of reputable think tanks from all across the political spectrum.
Look, we're out of time, but you've lived here. You said 5 years. Is there anybody dumber than a think tank employee in D.C.? Honestly, I've been here 30 years, and I'm asking you.
Well, I'm a lobbyist, so probably a lobbyist,
right.
I would say.
There's nobody. Just answer. There's nobody dumber or more detached from reality. I know that for a fact. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Tucker.
For joining us. You know what I'm talking about.